What's up, y'all? Welcome to the Top Flight Podcast. You know what it is. You know what we're here to do. Back in studio, beautiful Austin, Texas, with some unexpected rain. To my left, I got my boy B. How are you doing, B?
Hey, what's up, bro? Doing good. Man, I'm ready to talk about the game. Ready to talk about it with y'all, especially. Glad to be in the studio on Sundays. Sundays are for Top Flight.
The game we're referring to is which one, B?
Bro, we just destroyed Atlanta 3-0. We're going to get into it. I'm excited, bro.
Easy Eastern Conference. And to my right, let's introduce him, y'all. The Big Bad Wolf himself, Bali ATX. What's up, Bali? How are you?
I'm good, baby. I'm buzzing. I'm excited because destroyed ATL. Destroyed them.
The whole East.
Yeah, I was smoking on that pack yesterday.
New York soon. New York Red Bull soon, but they got to come to the queue.
That's going to be a good game.
Anything you want to say to the fans?
Thank you for supporting. Bali loves you.
Bali loves you.
Yeah, Bali loves everyone.
All right.
Except B.
Oh, okay. We're going to get to that here in a bit. And on the ones and twos.
I don't need your love.
Fuck
bro.
You.
On the ones and twos, relax. On the ones and twos.
I don't need your love.
We got Primo. How are you, Primo?
I'm doing good, bro. Yesterday's game was crazy, bro. It was a big game. Destroyed Atlanta. But yeah, pretty good.
100%, bro. Now, we do have to address something, how the last episode ended. A lot of fans hit us up on the DM. They said, hey, y'all, what happened? Why did the episode cut like that unexpectedly? B, you want to kind of tell the fans what happened? Why did we have to cut it like that?
I don't got to say what happened. I'm just saying, you know, we want to keep the show going. We want to be professional here, so... You know, we apologize for the episode ending short like that. All I'm going to say is that we won't let that happen anymore. We got to focus on the talk and the football in Austin. So,
Bali,
that's more important.
Bali, you also want to tell the fans what happened?
I don't care, man. I keep the same energy. I don't care. I keep the same energy.
I think we can move on, bro. I think we should move on.
Yeah, we should move on. Well, I guess I'll just have to tell the people, bro. We had to cut it off because Bali and B threw hands.
Y'all should have posted it.
Nah, we can't post that stuff.
You know what I'm saying? It is what it is.
But let's get into the football. Primo, give us the first topic of the Top Flight Podcast, please.
First topic, it's going to be just a game, bro. Overall thoughts of yesterday's big game.
Yes, the overall thoughts. We do got to dive right into it, y'all. Austin FC versus ATLB. Massive result on the road. Give us your overall thoughts on this game, bro.
Bro, massive result on the road. You know, this adds to our away form, which is fucking great. But yeah, man, we completely destroyed Atlanta. I was happy for the clean sheet. Also, you know, just as important as the 3 goals for me. And yeah, I mean, the biggest thing that I got out of this game, what stood out the most for me, was the performances of two players, bro. And that's Felipe and Finley. I think Felipe and Finley's performance in this game is probably the best performance they've ever provided us with in an Austin FC jersey, bro. I think they're best games, both Finley and Felipe, in my opinion. You know, the second goal was a complete tap-in, utter mistake, but we'll take it. I'm happy Drewsy got on the score sheet as well, bro. I mean, so many good things to say. I'm glad, like I mentioned earlier, the clean sheet matters just as much as the 3 goals to me, bro. So
100%. Yeah. Bali, B gave us his overall thoughts on this game. What do you want to tell the fans on your take on this game? How did you see it, bro?
It was a good game. You know, we came in and did the work. You know, destroyed them. ATL, I was shocked how poor this ATL team is.
Yeah,
how shitty this team is, bro. I mean, they're in the mud. And then the Joseph, after the game, calling out the players, the board, everybody. That team, ATL, is down bad right now.
That's
down bad. So, you know, we came in. We did the job with the – I think that – I think I have to agree with B, you know, Finley and Felipe, you know, came in and – did the work, you know. I've been four goals, four assists for Finley.
Yep.
Hey, he's on fire right now.
He's on fire right now. Catching fire at the perfect time right now, bro.
Yeah, and then I think that we will see more of Finley because Josh Wolf did say that his son Owen is something with his quad is bothering him.
Yes.
So you know, I told it. What did Bali tell y'all? You know, all this pressure on a kid is a lot of pressure. Injuries are coming.
Ooh.
So yeah, he's young, Finley came in. And he did great, man. He's on fire right now. I think we have to shout out this guy again. Ruben Gabrielson again, bro. What a wall. I mean, the defense, he is unbelievable.
Elite player.
Yeah. And I think there's officially two players that start every game and you can't drop unless you want to give them rest. And that's Gabrielson and Drewsy.
Really?
Yeah. You can't drop him. Nah. Fagu? I mean, you can rotate Fagu maybe, but
Julio?
Starting, Ruben and Drewsy. You can't drop those guys.
What about Stu?
I think so. I like Stu. Maybe Stu. Okay. I like Tarbo too.
Tarbo is also a pretty good keeper. I like Tarbo too. He's a pretty good keeper. Shout out Tarbo. But Primo, can you bring up the Austin FC lineup real quick? I want to read that off. For the fans that are listening to us, and if you're checking us out on YouTube, where you can follow us as well. At keeper, we have Brad Stuver, right back, Nick Lima, who gets the start over Hector Jimenez. Hector Jimenez, though, who was probably just left off the rest. He's been playing well. Ruben Gabrielsen with the partnership, Julio Cascante, who had an interesting game. He was coming off of a hamstring injury. Yeah. So we're going to talk about that.
Surprising start.
At left back, we had John Gallagher, who played well. He pretty much bullied Zanny out of his spot.
I think Zanny kind of lost it.
Yeah,
he went to bed on that, bro.
Yeah, bro. It's done for him. Bro. Yeah. He lost his position.
Gallagher honestly took that spot. Shout out Gallagher. He's one of those hard workers, man. Yeah, one of the hard workers. Then at the right middle, we have Ethan Finley, who probably, like B said, had the best game of his career. Or in Austin FC jersey, he had the highest rating in the squad with 8.4. In the middle, we have Alex Ring, the captain, who was at the number 6. Played phenomenal. Josh Wolf said that we controlled the game the way that we did because of Alex Ring last night. He had a lot to do with it. We also have Owen Wolf, like Bali said, did pick up a small knock. That was confirmed by Josh Wolf in the press conference. The hell was that? That was weird. I don't know.
I never heard that ringtone before.
That's not a ringtone. I don't know.
You good,
That is strange. Yeah. Moving on. Felipe Martins was up there as well. He got a goal with a 7.7. Danny Husen got the start and had left some fans raising their eyebrows. I don't know. Diego Fagundes with a 6.9. What are your thoughts on this lineup, B?
I mean, dude, Felipe, essentially, I know the graphic shows him playing right wing, but he played in Drewsy's position. Finley was in that right wing position. We had Alex Ring and Owen Wolf. Essentially, we had Wolf coming in for Danny's position, and we had Felipe coming in for Drewsy's, and then Finley going on that right wing. So, you know, the difference in quality between Felipe and Drewsy is, like, insane. And for him to do what he did, I mean, that just says a lot for his performance. I was happy as hell with Felipe and Finley. I think Wolf played a game, too, man. Wolf, you know.
He took credit. Did you see?
He took credit for the assist.
He took credit for the game plan and the strategy. Mm. Josh Wolf.
He praised his son.
Okay. Yeah. No, I'm saying Josh Wolf took credit for coaching wise. I'm sorry. I thought you meant Coach Wolf. Oh, but you were talking about Team Wolf.
No. Baby Wolf.
Very confusing.
Baby Wolf.
Keep going, B.
Baby Wolf. You know. So we all were interested into seeing how we would line up, bro. Because we had Danny out. We had Kip out. Julio was supposedly injured.
Questionable.
Maxi was, had an injury himself. So we were like, what are we going to do? When the Colorado game ended, we were already speculating. Yeah. Is Wolf going to play in the midfield? Is Finley going to come back? Yeah. We were all thinking. So we finally saw the lineup. And when I initially saw it, I was like, ah, man, that midfield, man. We had Wolf, baby Wolf. We had Ring and Felipe in that midfield. Fuck, I wasn't very confident, especially Felipe playing in that Drewsy position. Because we saw Felipe come in for Danny, and he didn't provide for us.
Yeah,
bro.
He did not provide.
I forgot what game that was. I think it was against Dallas. But
multiple games.
Yeah, multiple games. So I was like, I wasn't very confident, but fuck, did he show us out, bro. Felipe playing the best game he's had in this jersey. Same thing for Finley. So it worked out. And look, you said it earlier right now. Credit goes to Coach Wolf. Coach Wolf made this, bro. He put out this lineup. He entrusted Felipe. He entrusted Finley to do a job, and they did, bro.
100%. Now, Bali, when you see this rotated lineup, this rotated squad, Primo, can you bring the starting 11 up one more time? When you saw this graphic hit the Twitter timelines, what were your first thoughts when you saw the players that we were starting? Because in the morning of the game day, there was some birdies chirping. There was some sources talking. They were saying that this was going to be a rotated lineup where I told the fans it was going to be an interesting lineup. That's what I said. Mm-hmm. What were your thoughts when you saw this starting 11 from Josh Wolf?
I'm not going to lie, I was kind of happy because that means that you give Drewsy and Maxi a little bit of rest for the derby, okay. A big game. Okay. I said it, man, you have to rotate these players because injuries are coming. We have to rotate them. If Drewsy gets injured, we're fucked. Straight up, G, we're done. We're done out here. Yeah, if he gets injured, we're done. So we need to protect our players. Maxi's been very key to us too. So we got to give him some rest. I want to give maybe Ruben, maybe give him a little rest too. And maybe after the derby games, give him a little rest. You got to give these players rest, bro, because, it's a lot. We still have a long way to go. And then we have playoffs too. So we need to focus.
Yep. Question, Bali. You say that we would be done without Drewsy. What do you say to the fans that would you know, tweet you later on after we drop this podcast, the fans are going to say, hey, we scored two goals without Drusy on the field. What do you got to say to those fans?
Come on, bro. Come on. Stop with that. Stop with that.
And then did we not score two goals with Drusy not on the field?
Somebody say, we play better without Drusy.
Somebody did say that. Somebody did say that.
I almost passed out. I almost passed out of sickness. Oh, you know, God. Because come on, bro.
Yeah. Shit tweet.
We are much, much better with Drusy. Yes. Much, okay. much better. He is the diamond of this team, bro. He is la cabeza.
And to H's point about us scoring two goals, I mean, yeah, we did score two goals. Felipe had the game of his Austin FC career. So did Finley. And plus, Atlanta, they were shit, bro. They were shit.
Yeah, I think if I'm not mistaken, actually, this is a confirmed number. They've suffered their 20th injury so far this season. So that turf is not doing them any favors. Gonzalo Pineda, the coach, I loved him as a player. But as a coach, man, he's not having a good time in Atlanta. He had a good spell in Seattle. Yeah. He did pretty good over there. Then he got that head job after Gabriel Heinze left, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. And it's just been downhill from there, man. It's not been working out for him.
That turf, man.
He's my guy. But he's as a coach for ETL, it's not been working out for him. Yeah. But Bali, I have one more question for you. It was about Sebastian Drusy. He came on with about maybe 20, 15 minutes of PT. Are you happy he came on and he got some rhythm, or would you rather let him rest all the way until Houston?
Well, he came on and he scored. So, you know, that's good. That's good. But he was getting hit a lot, bro. He was getting hit a lot. So, man, I don't know, man. I'm glad that he scored. He could have scored two, hit the post, unlucky. But, I mean, I'm always happy to see Sebas come in. You know, what I am worried about is just him getting injured and him – being targeted a lot by these players because they know he's a star, bro. They know he's the guy.
MLS All-Star for sure.
For sure.
MVP. Same question for you, B. Were you happy to see Drusy get some minutes, or did you want to see him on the bench to get some rest?
I was happy that he got the rest in the first half, and I was also happy that he came on, bro. I mean, you know, with a player like him, you can't just – it would be – rest is good. And I think too much rest it gets tricky, bro. So I think he got the perfect amount. I think he got rested, so he only played a half. And he got his momentum going. He scored another goal to keep up with the leading goal scorers. You know, maybe he's
that golden boot loaded.
Golden boot. So it's loading. He loves that shit. So yeah. I'm happy, bro. This is masterclass by Wolf, bro. The lineup, the performances, the resting, the rotations was just beautiful, bro. I loved it. Even Redes came on and he played well, bro. Like,
yeah, fans, you know, were saying, some fans on Twitter were saying, B,
stop that.
That Redes has been turning into this player that the last 15 minutes when he comes on, he gives everything that he got. And they appreciate that from him because he's showing some fight. Well, somebody else said, you can go off on this. Somebody else said that the new signing of Washington Corozo, that has kind of lighted a flame underneath his butt. You know, this is kind of like a warning to Redes that if he doesn't start turning up, that he's not going to travel. He's not going to make the team anymore. Thoughts on that?
Dude, you know, praises for him. He was so bad that we're praising him for playing good for 15 minutes.
Damn.
And if that's what 2.75 million gets you is, he played good for 15 minutes. Oh, come on.
Good point. Thank
you. He is so deep in the hole that it's so hard. For him to get out of that hole, he needs to be scoring mad goals and just juking. And he's just too deep, bro.
Would you give him one more season at Austin, or you think Austin is looking to get rid of him this summer?
If there's an offer that comes by, which there won't be, I would sell him off. But there won't be an offer. Okay. A team is looking to buy a player. They're going to see the footage. And they're going to see 15-minute footage, 15 to 10-minute clips of him coming off the bench for Austin FC. And you're trying to claw back that 2.75 mil. It's not going to happen, bro. So I would just take the L, ride it out, hope he grows, and just keep him at the club. That's what I would do. But since we're on the lineup topic, if there, like, we've been praising players like Felipe and Finley. If there's any players I haven't spoke to or given praise to, I want to give it to Nick Lima because he had a fucking game. Okay. You know, Jimenez is coming off probably the worst performance he's had in the Austin FC jersey against Colorado.
Chill out.
I mean, you got to be real. In my opinion, probably one of the worst performances personally that he's had for the club.
He did look a little flat-footed that game.
And then Nick Lima coming in doing great, bro. He is now took pole position in that right back position. So I want to give him the praise he deserves. Fago did well. And then if anybody have any little downside or any any doubts, would be Houston. I mean, he started the game. He missed the sitter. Other than that sitter miss, That's it.
He had one chance where he could have toe poked it, like Maxi against Minnesota.
Yes, when he was on, when the keeper grabbed it.
And that honestly separates Maxi Urruti and Danny Huston. Yes. Maxi Urruti es un jugador de barrio.
Yes.
And he knows that sometimes you got to be cheeky. So. Danny Huston has been caught in these moments where he tries to be too cute.
It's almost like he's too heavy or something. He's not agile.
But honestly, that's just like a footballer that hasn't had that continuity that you would want to have. You know what I'm saying? Those consecutive games under your belt.
So, I mean, from what I saw the first half, because he came off the first half, he didn't do much, if any, at all. So that's the only thing that I have in the lineups, bro.
Before we go into the next topic, Bali, is there any player from the starting 11 that you would like to highlight other than Ethan and Felipe? Because we're going to talk about them in a bit.
For sure, Ruben. I've been saying it. Yeah. You know, he's the guy back there. You know, I feel so safe with him. And, you know, I'm happy for him.
Yeah. All very, State? Very.
And Gallagher, too. My God, bro.
Oh, okay.
You know what? This guy isn't even a left back. And he said, you know what? I'm gonna make this position mine. I'm going to work hard this offseason. And he came in this season and proved it, man. So I'm very, very happy for Gallagher.
On the commentary, I think it was Lahuth who said that Wolf asked anybody, does anybody want to play left back? And that Gallagher raised his hand saying, I used to play when I was a kid.
Hey.
And then there you go. I heard that on the commentary.
A guy that wants to play. A guy that wants to fight for this team. Bro, he wants to play for Austin FC.
So many great careers in the world of football have started like that. One of my favorite stories, Casemiro. When he was trying out in Brazil, he was trying out as forward. And there was like 60 or 80 kids trying out as forward. And there was only like 6 or 8 CDMs. So whenever the coach said, who's forward? 80 kids put their hand up. And the coach's like, okay. Yeah. And the coach said, who wants to play CDM or who is CDM? And like 6, 8 kids put their hand up. He was like, fuck it. I'm a fucking CDM. Because he wanted to get noticed.
Yeah.
Now, Champions League winner, baby. The rest is history.
Yeah, he should have never played in his life.
You need to chill out, bro. You need to chill out. Primo, take us into the next Austin FC topic.
Next topic, we're gonna just going to highlight some quick players again. Felipe, Finley, and Ruben. Amazing performances from all three of them.
Bali highlighted Ruben, go ahead and go in on Felipe and Ethan.
Oh,
Finley.
Yeah. I mean, Felipe and Finley, I've been kind of mentioning them since the beginning of the pod, but they, like I said, I'm going to say it again. They played their best game in this jersey, bro. Their best game in this jersey. Finley is starting to build consistency, so I'm happy to see that as well. I know Felipe got a lot of shit when he came in for Danny. He didn't do much. He's an aggressive player. I know he fouled that Charlotte player 2 seconds into the game.
Felipe. Yeah. Funny guy.
But, dude, man, you know.
Look at him.
Look at him. He's like, get out of the way.
I'm going out of here. Don't touch me.
I love Felipe's attitude.
He went to celebrate with coach.
Yeah.
And the team and the bench.
Yeah. So, you know, probably man of the match. If I had to pick man of the match, I would split it between those two players, bro.
Ethan got it.
Well deserved.
I think because, and this is like a Felipe Ethan segment. I think because Finley, you know, he's on 4 goals, 4 assists, but he also got a goal and assist in back-to-back games.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Let's not forget that against Colorado, he got that first goal, inspired that big-ass comeback, that huge comeback. And then this game, you know, he has a badass cross to Felipe, puts it on a platter, and then you know he's just for his age to be this alive in the box beating these younger cats from ATL, he's just got to give him credit because he's alive on his feet. You got to know that the ball is going to bounce shit cross from the ATL right back. He got like a 5.4 rating, but the fact that Ethan Finley knows that the ball's going to be live in the box and he's there, cleans it up, scores his goal. Credit to him
for sure, 100%. So I mean, we've been harping on both of them this game. I think they deserve to be the main topic for this game, bro. Both of them. So
Bali, anything you want to say on Ethan Finley and Felipe?
Great job, guys. Keep, when your name is called up, keep stepping up like you are. We loving it. Keep doing it.
Beautiful.
Yeah. And this is also a big statement from Ethan Finley, you know, because we did sign Washington, right? We're also rumored with Emiliano Rigoni, who we're gonna talk about in a bit.
Rigoni.
Italiano.
He's from Argentina.
His citizenship, though, is just like Drusy's. Argentinian, Italian.
Okay.
Argentinian, it is. But we're going to get that in here in a bit. But Ethan Finley is saying with this game and also the Colorado game, he's saying like, hey, you are signing players, but don't forget, aquí está Finley.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm here too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And like, earlier this season, you said that Ethan Finley was just brought in to fill a spot. But right now, I feel like he's trying to earn his spot.
Well, with the Ceci situation, we're lacking that spot. So any signing that was brought in to fill in the gaps are now asked to be the the filler. So I'm excited how he's evolving in form, bro.
Theory. A lot question. Of people. Question. What's up? You know how we have the most. Well, we're going to get that here in a bit. You know what? Never mind. I'm going to save this question for the next one.
What I was going to mention is that a lot of people at the beginning of the season, Finley was like, he was getting a lot of heat, bro. A lot of shit. You know what I'm saying? Even I remember one time he tweeted something like, oh, no, Finley came on. Fuck. And then he scored like two goals. And then you're like, well, Finley, sorry for that. Yeah. So, you know, you weren't the only victim. There's a lot of people out there that were hating on Finley. So I'm just happy to see him, you know, prove himself. So I hope he keeps going, man.
Primo, if you could keep scrolling down a bit, there's a stat there about Felipe, about his career stats, his goals and assists. If you could, right there, it says Felipe's goal versus Atlanta was the 80th goal contribution of his MLS career. 25 goals, 54 assists. He is the 12th different player to score for Austin FC in 2022.
Nice.
Fantastic.
Nice.
We're scoring, baby. Yeah. Everybody's scoring.
Yeah. Primo, before we go into the next topic, anything you want to add on Finley and Felipe?
I mean, they're just stepping it up, bro. I mean, this is the time where we're struggling with
pushing P
with these guys to show up. You know, these guys weren't really showing up at the beginning of the season. You know, Finley caught a lot of heat, but I'm just glad that
a lot of heat,
bro.
Some people were tweeting shit.
And then
bro.
Since then, he's just kind of been going off. And you know, it's good that these guys are willing to step up, because whenever we're trying to rest these main guys like Drusi and
Fagu, Maxi and Fagu, Danny.
These guys need to step it up, bro. Yeah, like we're still not done with the league, so I'm just glad that these guys are showing up.
We need every single person on this roster, bro.
Even the Redes, like
even
you said.
The Redes for 15 minutes to come and do a job, bro. Even Redes.
I always laughed that one time you were like, "Well, it's his job, brother." it's his job, brother. Yeah. It's his job.
It is.
It's his job.
He's getting paid.
Yeah. What else is he gonna do?
Yeah, true.
Spend them checks.
Save him.
Bro, a lot of people were actually bringing that up now you said that. Pretty well. Take us into the next topic, please.
Next topic, it's going to be Austin FC's away record.
Yes.
Yeah. 22 Ooh. Points yes. on the road.
Now, I had a really good question waiting for you, B, and this is what it is.
What's up, bro?
Do you think, so we have 22 points on the road. That's a lot of points, like you were saying earlier, Bali. 22 Marvelous. Points is what we've earned on the road. Completely 180 turn from last season. Last season, we couldn't catch a break on the road. Do you think that the success of Austin FC on the road is due to the amount of competition in this squad, bro? Because we have Gallagher competing with Zanny. We have Hector competing with Lima. We have Ethan competing with Teen Wolf, competing with Ronnie Redes, right? Mm-hmm. Do you think that has to do with it, bro?
I think it definitely the competition definitely has a part of it. But I think the biggest, and this is just my personal opinion on, like to your question, the reason why we're doing good away, I feel like it's just the togetherness of the squad, bro. Mm-hmm. Like the Drusi, the Maxi, the Fagu of like the Gaberson's, you know, leadership roles. I think they're like buddies. They're like friends. So I think that has more of a role to do with the away performances, but also the competition. You know, I mean, everybody wants to do well, and you know, better way to do it when you play away has also a factor. But I think the togetherness of the squad is more of a factor on this away performance, bro.
Bali, same question to you, man. Do you think, you know, the competition in the squad has to do with those 22 points away from home? And also, what's your take on Austin FC away from home? Because we're massively better this season.
Oh, man, it's been a complete turnaround, like you said, man. And I think that togetherness is also very, very key, because we see these players, they're celebrating after the game. They hug each other.
With the bear?
You know, with the bear. With
the bear, Teak.
So, man.
That's the bear's name?
Teak Martins.
Teak Martin.
Okay. Build a bear workshop.
And man, this team is a complete turnaround. I think some of the quality of the players that came in, like Ruben, for example, coming in. You know, even Ethan, you know, Felipe, these guys, they've been around the league for a while. You know, last year we did have a lot of young players in our team. Now we have some veterans there that could lead the guys through, give them some tips on the game. So I think I have to agree with B that togetherness of this team, it's something that it's special to see. You see the videos after the game, the little clips. They're together, bro.
Shout out to this media team.
Unbelievable.
Shout out to her.
The media team is killing it, bro. Yeah. They are killing it, bro. The videos are unbelievable. The whole team is amazing, bro. And you know, and I think even Felipe said in his interview after the game, he said, everyone's happy for each other when they come in, you know? There's no ego in here. If you come in for me, man, I'm happy. Go off. Go off and prove something, bro, because we need you.
Yeah.
And bro, right now it's very, very special, bro. And we're building something special here. And I'm very happy. I think we're going far this season.
And also on Austin FC, I feel like a lot of players see Austin FC as like a fresh start, bro.
An opportunity.
Bro.
I love that. You know what I mean? Because
Austin FC is new, love bro. Yeah. There's nothing there. You go to LAFC, there's legends that have played there. There's a the Gerard played there. He's
technically. No, Gerard played in Galaxy.
You said
LAFC.
LAFC got no legends.
I was about to say, they ain't got right. no legends.
They're not even champions. MLS right. champions.
They got the shield.
What I meant to say was Galaxy. Yeah. You know, the Seattles, the all these clubs that like you go to, there's like, it's already in motion. So with Austin, it's like it's a new club. It's like a clean sheet. It's almost like a fresh start.
Write your story, lad.
You know, like we talked about before the pod, man, off the mics, we were like, I think Julio, this is probably the best form of his career.
And
the opportunity was here. Come to Austin. Do your best. And I feel like a lot of players are.
We got Julio from the second division Portland Timbers team, correct?
Yes, bro.
Yeah. If we wouldn't have picked him up, Julio would have probably spent the rest of the last years of his career in a B team.
Yeah.
So we picked him up and he's been going off.
And that says a lot to his performance because he's like, man, you know, look where I was at. Now I'm at Austin FC. It makes you want to show out, bro. Yeah. You know what I mean? So I'm excited how everything is going.
Not only that, shout out to Julio and La Manchita, Washington, Corozo. They have World Cup hopes, bro.
Yes. Julio with the Costa Rica and then Washington with Ecuador, man. Yeah.
We're going to get a little bit more into Washington here in a bit. But
his middle name is Brian, too, by the way, right?
Really? On his Instagram. On his Instagram, it says Brian.
Yeah.
And y'all spell it the same way, too, which is kind of unique.
Why? You don't see it with a Y that often.
You don't really see it with a Y. You don't really see it with a Y.
Shout out Brian.
Shout out all the Bryans. Brian Bros.
Brian Bros.
Brian Bros. Brian Bros.
Hit the games, Brian
Bros.
Yeah, shout out Paul.
Anything else we can add on the away record for Austin FC? Primo, anything you want to add on this topic? We've been fantastic. Shout out to Wolf.
Let's go. It's been a crazy season so far, bro. We're making playoffs and it's
100%.
I'm gonna say something.
100%.
Hot take. Wolf in, bro.
Damn.
Wolf in, bro.
Bali?
Hot take, bro. Wolf
I'm looking
in.
At you.
That's not even a hot take, bro.
I'm looking at you.
That's the whole point. That's the whole point.
He's driving us and taking us to the promised land,
goddamn
bro.
Goddamn right, brother.
If you could say something.
Goddamn right, brother.
If you could say something to Josh Wolf, what would you say?
We already talked.
It should
we
say.
We did talk. We did talk.
You should say, I'm sorry.
No, we talked. We had a great conversation.
Did you apologize?
He told me, I understand because the first season was horrible, bro.
As expected.
Not as expected. Because as expected. Some teams had great seasons.
How do you know Reyes was going to be so shit if you don't give him a chance to play?
He did play, and he played pretty
and
good.
And he was shit.
He was MVP. Reyes was MVP in our preseason.
Manny Perez. You know? Kekuta. So, I mean, what happened, right?
The first season made me sick, and we wanted him out, and a lot of people wanted him out, and we stand by it. And if... we don't make playoffs if for some reason we don't make playoffs, then the pressure's back on. We're back on the same energy. So right now we're doing great. He's leading us and we're happy. Everyone's happy.
Bro, actually, Bali, real quick for the fans, Diego Fagundes even said on Mate Con Vos, two episodes ago, he said, Bali, you're very calm this season.
Yeah.
Remember he said that?
Yeah,
and
we are calm. We're chilling. Even Diego's dad, he said, bro, we were all upset too first season, but you know what?
We're chilling.
Let's trust him. Let's see what happens. And hey, man, look, it's going great, bro. We're doing awesome. Playoff bound. And I don't know, man. I have a weird feeling in my heart this season. I don't know.
Foresaw it? How do you say it?
No, you said it right, but if I'm going to say it, it has to be foresee it, I think.
Yeah. Foresaw it, bro.
Yeah, you foresaw it, he foreseed it, I think.
Yes.
I don't know, something like that.
Yeah.
Right?
I don't know. That I should have gone to English class more often.
Oh, chill out, bro. Pretty well, take us into the next topic, please. Shout out to Austin FC for their away record, man. The East, easy Eastern Conference.
Easy
bro.
Work.
6-1-0, man. Nobody can beat us from the East. We got New York Rebels next, soon, at the Q, but...
I'm excited for that.
I'm excited for that game.
And Philadelphia's a good team, too, man.
Shout out to I-80 Sports. So, we got the koozie right there.
Boy, they
7-0, bro.
Yeah, they did. 7-0. They're a good team, man.
They're not that good,
NYFC's
bro.
NYFC's a good team, too.
They're not a 7-0 good team, way.
I think DC's that trash, right?
Fluke-ass scoreline.
Is DC that trash?
We came back on them, bro.
Yeah.
We came back on them. They can't be that good, G. Primo, next topic, please.
Next topic is going to be our latest signing, bro.
Washington Corozo.
Bienvenido, Washington Corozo.
Welcome, Washington Corozo.
Bienvenido. On loan. It's a loan.
6 month loan, just for the season, right?
Yep.
6 month loan. Now let's get into the topic real quick. Washington Corozo arrives to Austin FC on a 6 month loan from Sporting Cristal. But before Sporting Cristal in Peru, he was on loan at Pumas of Mexico, and he featured in the CONCACAF Champions League final against Seattle. Although they got spanked, Seattle took the dub, but it is important to mention that.
Yes.
B, what can you tell the fans about Washington Corozo? And then, Bali, I'm going to have you on next.
I mean, look, man, Ecuador.
Well, bro, I just spoke like if we were on a Twitter space, bro. Waffle. Go ahead.
No, man, you know, a winger, Ecuador, you know. I heard a lot of that he has World Cup hopes, like we mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
What I've been seeing of him is that he's good with one-on-ones, you know, as you would want from your wingers. A lot of people on Twitter were – I'm not saying a lot. It was only a few people.
I'm going to say something.
People were crying.
People were saying cry another Redis. That's what I heard, bro.
Some fans said that.
I'm like, when a player comes in, you got to see what he's got, bro.
Let
you
him kick a ball, mate.
No one knew Gaberson was going to do this well. No one knew, and he's doing well.
Julio. The same people that were talking mess about Washington, a lot of those same people were talking shit about Ruben whenever we signed him.
Exactly.
They were like, oh, this guy's from Toulouse. Yes. He's from the French second division. A lot of the same people were looking silly and again.
Like we mentioned earlier, Julio, we got him off the second division of Portland, bro. So, like, also I mentioned earlier, Austin FC is almost like a clean sheet of like here, like, a fresh start. Show yourself.
It's a new frontier.
So with all that taken into account, you can't just flat out say, let's give him. He didn't come on. He traveled with ATL. He couldn't play because I think there was an issue with the international stuff. Something going on.
Yeah.
But let's see him play. I'm excited, bro. I'm excited.
Before I get to you, Bali, one thing that we do got to mention is the beautifulness of this deal. I mean, this deal has very little to lose and so much to gain. I don't understand why people can't get that through their mind.
That's a badass.
People
take,
need
bro.
To understand, bro, that he didn't arrive as a DP. Did not arrive using TAM money. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He just acquired an international roster spot, and he's a six-month loan. If it doesn't work out, we're good. It's not like Ronnie Redes where we're stuck with him paying him. Yes. We're stuck with Ceci paying him. I want to give a shout-out to Claudio Reyna for working this deal, bro.
Beautiful.
Honestly,
beautiful.
I mean, this guy played in Pumas. You know, he played in the CONCACAF Champions League final. He has experience. And I want to read real quick before I get you in, Bali. It says, Austin FC is an ambitious club. This is from Washington. Austin FC is an ambitious club in a great city with a terrific fan base, said Corozo. I want to thank Claudio Reyna and Josh Wolf for this opportunity, as well as my agent, and look forward to being a part of the club. I'll give everything I have for Austin FC and can't wait to step out under the lights at Q2 Stadium.
Yeah, yeah. Before you go to Bali, I just want to mention, I just want to highlight your take again. It's essentially you're telling me, hey, 6 months loan, show us what you got. Doesn't work out, it's fine. We'll move on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's beautiful, bro. How can people hate on that, bro?
Not only that, the genius to know that this player is trying to make it to the World Cup. He has an opportunity. You know he's going to ball out.
Exactly. And if he does live, hey, what's up?
Maybe Why would you want to go back to Sporting
Cristal?
You want to stay in Austin.
Exactly.
You want to stay in the MLS.
It's a win-win-win-win situation.
All around.
So everybody talking shit, fuck off, bro.
A lot of the people talking mess are the same people that were talking mess about Ruben. That's what I'm going to say. Yeah. Bali, give us your take on La Manchita, Washington Corozo.
La Manchita, Washington. Hey, I've been seeing him, man. He looks good one-on-one. I've been seeing some of his interviews, catching up, trying to see what I can find about the guy. His desire to play in Ecuador and Qatar is huge.
Yeah,
I mean, he is hungry for that. And that's good for us because he's coming here. He's trying to prove something. He wants to go to Qatar. He wants to go and represent the national team. So he also said that Europe is his dream. So he knows that coming to Austin FC, it's just one step closer to that dream coming to Europe.
You come in here,
you go off, you get signed, and you move forward, bro. You can go to Europe maybe. So it's huge. It's huge, La Manchita. I'm happy for him.
Guess what, too? There's shit to play for here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's something to play for here.
We're fighting for every single trophy right now.
We're fighting for the shield.
Except the Open Cup. We're not fighting for the Open Cup.
Let's not bring that up anymore.
My fault. My bad.
There is shit to play for in this club. You know what I mean? So, 100%. Wow, it's great business. This move is genius. This move is great. I love this move.
Yeah, it is. It is fantastic.
It's fantastic.
And not only that, for him, the right wing is wide open.
Come
in, do good, win the spot. You're a starter. Get a massive contract. Have a kid here. Start a family. You're in the MLS.
Play in the World Cup.
playing the World Cup. Austin is one of the greatest cities in the world to live in right now. Yes, what more do you want from this signing, bro?
Oh, God, he also said that when he was younger, I guess he was playing as a six. He went to a team of North America, and the coach actually told him, like, you're not a six, you're a winger.
Damn.
And ever since then, he's been playing wing.
Question, do you know why they call him La Manchita, way?
Supposedly, when he was younger, he was coming from the bottom, from the struggle, you know, playing in dirt, you know, with his friends and stuff. Yeah. He would always come home very dirty.
So
they would call him Manchita, you know?
Because Novis told me a reason, but I don't know if that was true.
Nah, Novis beyond that cap.
That wasn't the reason. But, man, I'm happy for him. He also mentioned that someone asked him a question of what's somebody that you look up to, like kind of like your little playing style that you kind of want to Mulet kind of look like, and he said Neymar. He said he likes how Neymar plays. Yeah. So el Neymar de Ecuador. El Neymar de Ecuador. Aquí está. Aquí está.
We had a Neymar from Paraguay. Let's see how we do a Neymar from Ecuador. No.
Forget about him. Forget about him, G. Forget. Yeah. Okay. Fuck him, bro.
Excited. Great move.
Real quick, I'm going to read a quote from the gaffer, Josh Wolf, on La Manchita, Washington Corozo, via Austin FC press conference. He said, he's got a six-month window coming here with us. We play a certain type of soccer. He can come in and help. He'll have to earn his minutes like everyone else. He has qualities that I think will help us. Washington brings an element where he can stay out wide and is very good isolated 1v1. Very shifty. He can take you down the line and get by you, or he can dip inside and ask different questions. That's from the gaffer, Josh Wolf himself.
Loved it, man. I'm excited, bro. I wish he would have came at least on for 15 minutes in Atlanta, but he couldn't. So maybe against Houston, we'll see how that game goes, man.
Shout out to Primo for pulling up these highlights of Washington Corozo. Bro, he's fast.
He's fast. And good with both feet.
He's got handles, bro.
Bro, yeah. Neymar, te dije.
Just real quick before we change topics, I also want to just highlight the dumb logic behind, like, oh, why isn't Austin FC signing a Gareth Bale? We're not that team, bro. We're not that team, bro.
I saw Hazard.
Hazard. Oh, my God. Let's be real, man.
Are y'all trying to be funny? Or, like, what are y'all trying to do right now?
You got
to
be real, though. The people that are saying that, you look at them, you see, bro.
Dybala. I don't know, man.
Come on. I don't know, right now.
The thing that got me upset is the fact that we're playing good soccer. We're not playing superstar soccer. We're playing team football, mate. Yeah.
Look at Houston. I mean, they brought in a star just because he's a star. We bring in players because we want to be better on the pitch, not because we want to sell jerseys.
Yes.
We don't care about selling jerseys. Q2 beer is $20 a beer. You know what I mean?
The day that we turn into that club is the day that you'll start seeing these desperate signings.
That sucks. I don't want that.
You know what I'm saying?
I don't want that. Yeah.
Primo, take us into the next topic, please. Enough on those shitty fans. They are fans. Everybody,
clueless fans.
Everybody has opinions.
Yeah. He's a great player. Do you guys have anything else on Washington Corozo?
I'm good. I'm excited to see him play.
I'm excited. I'm not going to talk shit about a player I haven't seen play for a club. You know what I mean? I keep that 100. So.
Kind of silly, bro.
It's kind of weird, too. Yeah, it's almost like you want Clikes or some shit.
Let him do his job, mate. Yeah. Go ahead, Primo.
Our next topic, it's going to be our next two games, Copa Texas preview. We got Houston on Tuesday and Dallas on Saturday.
Back-to-back Texas derbies, boys. Copa Texas.
Definitely, we arrive in the best form of our life.
Yes, man.
We arrive, you know, undefeated against the East. We're in second place in the Western Conference. Houston and Dallas both tied last night, 2-2, if I'm not mistaken, in a crazy game that had fans throwing beer bottles or cups filled with beer and water to the field.
It was crazy to see.
Yeah, that was crazy to see.
You know what was crazier than that? Was the fact that there was some MLS pundit saying that they want to see more energy like that in the PNC Stadium. You want to see more of that, bro.
Oh, my.
You want to see more of fans throwing beer, alcoholic beverages to the players, bro. Yeah. Come on, I don't want to see that. I don't want to see that because y'all spent the whole summer talking shit about Mexico doing that. You're going to praise an MLS team for doing that? Nah, bro.
That's facts, bro. I mean, if I could pick out something.
Look at that right there. Look at that, mate.
And it wouldn't be so bad if they didn't go so hard on Mexico, bro, for doing the same thing. And now you want that in the MLS?
Yeah.
Like, come on, bro. Give me a break. But the rivalry, I like the intensity. On the pitch. You know what I mean?
Look at all those bottles, bro.
Look at that. Oh my God. That's embarrassing, bro. Yeah. But you know what was even funnier? The fact that this is a 93rd minute goal from Dallas. They thought they won it.
Yeah.
And then Houston comes back and ties it up. But what I was hearing from some of my buds in the Houston Dynamo Twitter world was the fact that two accounts or one?
Was it like one?
Five or six. They've actually been growing more now. is the fact that they played fantastic after Hector Herrera got subbed on. And I'm not going to lie, bro. I'm not going to lie. It's a very interesting thing to hear. And I'm not going to say that I'm worried. I am very confident in my team. But I am a little concerned that the players in Houston are going to be inspired on another level by having Achiacha on their team. What's y'all's takes on the derbies coming up?
I mean, I'm more confident for Houston. I know we've yet to beat Dallas, but, you know, Houston's coming up first, so I'll talk on Houston. Yeah, man, Achiacha could elevate his players around him, you know, motivate them or whatever. But I feel like with all that, I think we can still beat him. I think we're coming in hot, like you said, in the best form that we've been in probably ever. No, it is ever.
Ever.
And Houston is not. So I'm fairly confident, bro. I'm so confident. I don't think Achiacha would inspire them enough to beat us on Tuesday, especially we're at home, bro. We're at the Q. They come to Austin. So I got a dub, bro. I got a dub versus Houston. Now the Dallas one, we've yet to beat them, bro. That's the biggest game, in my opinion. I kind of disregard Houston. I think we can get 3 points there. I'm more worried and focused on the Dallas game, which is going to be away at Frisco.
Dallas is sitting in fourth place. Houston is sitting in 11th. Meanwhile, we're in second place right behind LAFC.
Yes.
Kaku with an interesting tweet last night, by the way.
The one about...
Bali, give us your take on the derbies.
Oh, man. I'm not really... Houston, you know, Herrera, abre tus ojos el martes. Oh. Abre tus ojos and look at a real stadium, a real fan base. You're going to see Herrera. You're going to see Tuesday. I promise you are. But I'm not really worried about Houston. I'll be real, I am a little worried about Dallas, though, because it is away from home. And, man, we can't knock it. You know, Dallas is a good team, man. Dallas is a good team. We tied against them at our house. They came in and they slapped us.
If we came back. If Tate Castellanos does end up leaving, the boot is between Drusi and Ferreira, who plays for FC Dallas.
Yeah, man. So it's they're a good team, man. And I just hope that we get something out of Dallas. If we win, fuck, happy. But Houston, I'm not worried about them, man. I'm not worried about them.
Not worried about them either, bro. Houston, not worried about them. Even with Achiacha.
Who cares?
With Dallas, man, we got to get a dub already, bro. This cannot keep going for much longer. For some reason,
we just can't get a dub already. We need to beat Dallas, bro.
We need to get a dub.
And also Copa Tejas B. You want to kind of tell the fans about that?
Yeah, you know, Copa Tejas, the best team in Texas. Dallas won the inaugural. Was it the inaugural?
Yeah.
Yeah, they won it last year.
Diego scored a badass goal that game.
Yeah. We were there.
I remember that. I was in the press box that game, bro.
Yeah. It would be a nice token. It just, I'm gonna say some real shit right now. Last year, fuck it, I'll be real. I don't think it, to me, it's kind of, the importance kind of dimmed down. Last year, it was such a big deal because of how shit we were. Yeah. So we hyped it up. But now, I'm just like, yeah, sure. But let's get this shield, bro.
They actually talk about it pretty often in, like, press conferences. Josh Wolf brings it up. Like, if, you know, it's like a trophy that we're fighting for.
I definitely want that trophy to be bigger than it is. I definitely want it to grow. So I'm in favor for it. It would be so awesome. I know we talked about it before. If, like, we can get a fourth Texas team, like a San Antonio or something in the MLS, to make it like a four Texas team competitive trophy, that would be lit. You know what I'm saying? I definitely want that trophy to grow.
That way it could be like a semifinal bracket.
Yes, bro. Like, yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, that would be insane.
That's like the Spanish Super Cup, right,
yeah,
Primo?
Yeah, yeah. I think but that's like how they do it, right?
Spanish Super Cup's like that. Yeah, yeah.
That would be dope.
Question, Primo. Yes or no? Can Austin FC win Copa Tejas this year?
Yeah, I think so. I think we're... like on the verge, I think we're tied with Dallas or something like that on points. But if we beat Dallas, that pretty much secures it. I think that's the last two games against them. So
we'd have to beat Houston.
Have to beat Houston.
Yeah.
Something we can do 100%.
Yeah.
Score prediction for the Houston game, B.
Oh, man, I got like a 3-1. 3-1, 2-1, something like that. We definitely score and win that game.
Primo, can you bring up Houston's recent form, their last couple of games? Bali, same question for you. What are your score predictions for the Houston Dynamo game?
For
on Tuesday at home.
2-0.
Okay.
Goals? 2-0. Drusi Dior. And, man, I'll say Washington Corozo.
Oh, shit.
Washington Corozo.
That's tough. I don't know about that.
What, bro? What, bro? So who's going to score?
You saying he's scoring on his debut?
Hey, I don't think he's going to start, but he's coming in from the bench. He's going to bring a shift. I'm telling you that.
He's scoring?
Hey, I think he's scoring.
I think
he's scoring.
Bro, they lost to Charlotte. 2-1.
And then whenever he scores, he's going to go to the bench. He's going to look right at Rodney's eyes. And say, hey, I'm here.
Step up.
I'm here. Real quick,
Houston's last couple of games, the last game, obviously they tied 2-2 against Dallas. They lost 2-1 against Charlotte. That was their first away win ever. Charlotte FC, congrats to them.
Wait, Charlotte beat Houston.
Charlotte beat Houston.
End it.
They lost to Portland, and Portland was down to 10 men. They beat Chicago 2-0, and they lost to Orlando City. So this is definitely a beatable team. They now have Ache Ache, though, and I was hearing some good things about his debut last night.
It's LLL tie.
Insert Ache Ache,
you tie. So I don't know. We'll see. I don't think Ache Ache is that much bigger of a boost, bro. In my opinion, I think.
Bro, I hope Drusy makes him look silly, man.
Oh, he will.
It is gonna be a juicy battle with him.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah. Danny's also gonna lock him up.
I'm gonna talk to Danny.
It's not enough, mate. Ache Ache is not enough. You gotta bring in more if you want to compete.
I like that, B. I like that. Anything else you want to add on the derbies?
That's it. I got a dub, and I got a dub, bro.
Dub.
I think we finally break this curse, bro. I'm excited right now. Yeah. Maybe that has a lot to do.
Two derbies back to back. It's going to be interesting.
Yeah, it is.
Primo, dubs?
Yeah, dubs.
Two dubs.
We have to get dubs, bro, especially against Dallas, because I'm tired of losing against them, bro. Yeah.
Bali?
We need those points.
Win, and I say I'll take the tie in Dallas, but I want to win. But I'll take the tie, though.
I say beat Houston, we tie against Dallas again.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
I say we tie against Dallas. Va a estar cabrón. Va a estar bien cabrón.
And they know they're playing Austin FC. They know, hey, we got, let's step up. Let's beat them.
It's a derby, man.
But we're already so hot. If we beat Houston, we're going to be even more hot. I mean.
Yeah.
Coming in hot. So I think this is the time to do it, bro. This is the time to do it. So we'll see.
Facts. All right. That's on the derbies. Primo. We have one more topic, if I'm not mistaken, right? It's the...
One last topic for Austin FC. It's the rumor that's going around. Emiliano Rigoni.
Bali, how excited are you for this game, bro? Not for this game, for this player.
Hey,
for this
man,
rumor.
He is disgusting with it, G. What? He is nasty with it, bro. He is...
Oh, the game. Oh,
His skills, bro. His agility is nice, and he's played with Drusy Dior, which, what a coincidence, you know? Hey, Emiliano, vente para acá para Austin.
Where does he play? What position?
He plays in Sao Paulo right now.
He plays right winger.
Right wing and left wing.
He looks very, very good, man. He looks fast. He looks saucy, just like another Drusy.
Yeah,
really.
He gives me Drusy vibes.
He is 29 years old, so some fans were saying, maybe he's on the older side of things. He's 29 years old. He played in Zenit from 2017 until 2021. He now plays in Sao Paulo, Brazil. Apparently, Football Critic was telling me, and we're going to read his thread here in a bit, was that he was doing pretty good, but then there was a coaching change, and he hasn't featured a lot. And the fans at Sao Paulo, some of them hate him, some of them love him. It was actually funny. I was looking through some of the tweets last night when I was going through the rumor. Mm-hmm. One of the fans was saying, like, Austin FC wants him? Take him to the airport in an Uber Black. I was like, jeez. Man, you know, that's the vibe down there, bro.
That's the vibe in South America with the fans. It's like, dude, you ain't scoring 10 goals a season. They are going to show up to your house. You know what I mean?
Now, B, one question I do want to ask you. What are your thoughts on Austin FC going after these Argentine players?
Yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of an Argentine, you know, desire to seek, I guess, in the club or something. And we got Maxi, we got Drusy. I mean, hey, chemistry. I'm down. I mean, I don't mind. I don't care if they're Argentine, Uruguayan, Brazilian. I don't care. As long as they're not Paraguayan. but yeah, dude, I mean, I don't care. Fuck it. You know, bring them in. Argentine connection, chemistry builds, you know, togetherness in the squad. I'm down, bro. I don't mind one bit.
100%. Primo, can you bring up Football Critic's thread? It's one of the first tabs.
Yeah, but to me, he's looks
badass
good,
thread
he
by
looks
Football
very,
Critic.
Very
dude,
good,
shout
bro.
Out to homie.
Bali, you want him in Austin FC?
Bro,
I think he wants
man,
him.
Man, I want. What can we do to get him here now, bro?
Before that, I read his thread last night. The news broke by We're Austin TV. You can follow us on Twitter.
Yes, sir.
We were saying that he is linked to Austin FC, right? Mm-hmm. But over the past couple of days, maybe the past week, a lot of journalists, verified accounts on Twitter, have been coming out with reports linking him to a move to the MLS with an unnamed MLS club. What does that tell you? That's Austin FC, bro. Austin FC likes to do business like that. You know what I'm saying? They don't like to put their name out there.
I guess what you're saying is, since the tweet came out that we tweeted, you know, the rumor has been getting stronger and stronger and stronger, bro.
Now, real quick, I'm going to read as much as I can. It says, number one, Football Critic shout out. It says, Emiliano joined Sao Paulo FC, and with his history of playing in Argentina and Russia, in Zenit with Drusi, Spain, etc., he looked to be a huge addition and help for the club. He had an explosive start, several months of goals, assists, and great plays. Became their savior many times. Everything was done under the coaching of Hernan Crespo. Shout out to my tocayo last year. Rigoni really shined. Sorry, let me read that one more time. Everything was done under the coaching of Hernan Crespo last year. Rigoni really shined. But things didn't go very well for the club as a whole later on. The club did pretty poorly and decided to fire Crespo. Oof. Crespo left, and it appears he took Rigoni's talent with him.
Oof.
Number six, with the new coach and his staff, Rigoni started to disappear in games. Didn't score, didn't assist, didn't do much as a whole. Apparently, he even became the sub of the sub. Oof. Ooh. Seven, as of today, Rigoni, Seni, former Sao Paulo FC goal scoring goalkeeper, biggest legend of the club, is the coach. Okay. Sorry, that one kind of didn't, sorry, I kind of butchered that one a bit. Number eight, he talked recently about Rigoni and highlighted several qualities of his. Oh, I get it now. These are Rigoni's highlights. He dribbles. He finishes. What is that word? He's
ambidextrous.
Ambidextrous? Yes. Ambidextrous. That's tough. Skillful and talented all around.
Yeah, skillful. His agility is nice, man. Yeah.
Nevertheless, he also said that Emiliano is going through a rough patch, as any player does. Rogero stated that he still believes in him and his talent. Reason why he's trying to give him 10, 20, 30 minutes of playtime each game so that Emiliano can find himself again. The club is looking to sell the player to get back their investment since he hasn't performed lately. Damn. There's no indiscipline, misconduct, or lack of work linked to the club wanting him out, apparently. But Rogero did say that Rigoni needs to get serious. Ooh. As a summary, Rigoni is a great player with skills that we definitely can use. He's got experience and has played with Drusi before. He's in a tough spot right now, but definitely has the quality to get better. Maybe MLS and Austin is the right place for that to happen. And then he adds Jao Paulo 633's words. In Jao Paulo's words, Rigoni was a beast in 2021 and one of the best players in Brazil under Crespo, but his talent disappeared and nobody knows what happened. When he wants, he looks like Di Maria, but when he doesn't, he can't even stop the ball under his feet. And finally, huge credit to We're Austin TV for being the best Austin FC fan base account and the first to, what did I say, Primo? The first to let us know about this great rumor of the transfer window.
Nice.
Shout out to Football Critic.
Great stuff, Football Critic. Great thread, bro. Yeah. You got it spot on. To me, it looks like the guy's looking for a home.
Yes.
And hey, yeah, it's here, baby.
You know what it is? Him and Drusi probably texting back. He's like, man, exactly. how things are going in Brazil? It's like, oh, man, you know, they fired the coach, the new coach.
Está de la mierda este boludo.
Y luego le dice a Drusi, how's things going in Austin? Oh, está toda madre, bro. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's fucking awesome here. So...
You know what Drusi says? He's like, bro, I'm in the race for the golden boot.
Yeah, bro.
I'm in the race for the golden boot. Imagine what you'll be doing here in Austin
exactly,
MC.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? So, man, I want him in, bro.
Yeah.
I want him in this club.
I'm very excited to see what this rumor is going to lead to. And now that we did tweet it, a lot of people close to the club have been coming out and confirming this rumor.
Man, this is blessing. I mean, fuck, don't be surprised if you see that Verde smoke anytime soon. So.
I heard that it might happen before this month ends. So before August, this guy might be in Austin FC.
Man, I'm excited, bro.
I'm excited, bro.
Exclusive info. This might be a done deal before July ends.
Man, he comes in. I think we lock in, bro.
I hope he does.
God, man, we're in great position to be fighting for the shield, bro.
You know what makes this link stronger? I think because we played with Drusi.
Yeah. Yes,
and everyone sees like, hey, he played with Drusi. Drusi's doing good. He can come here and help us.
And he's Argentine, just like Drusi, just like Maxi.
He arrived to Zenit at the same time and left Zenit at the same time, 2017 and 2021.
Man, what a time to leave Zenit at 2021.
Yeah, right? That's insane. That's so true. That's a perfect time to leave Russia, bro.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to add on this rumor, boys, on Emiliano Rigoni? I feel like there's a pasta named after him.
I want to add that the Washington signing was a fucking badass signing, 6 months loan, perfect. Shout out, Reyna. And then on the Emiliano, I'm excited to bring him in. It seems like he's coming. I hope it does. I hope it gets done ASAP so he can help the squad. All around, man, I'm excited, man. Reyna, showing us, bro. Showing us what's going on, bro. So I'm excited, bro.
100%. Bali, anything else you want to add on the overall segment of Austin FC?
I mean, trust in Reyna. trust in Claudio, man. I mean, if he brings this guy in too, madre mia.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, we're going to be a problem, a big problem. Yeah. Yeah.
Big
we're going to be a problem.
Yeah. Big problem. Now, B, you want to take us into the next chapter?
What we got going on next?
Well, I mean, that's pretty much it for the Austin.
That's it for the Austin FC segment, right?
We got more to talk about, though.
We got Europe. So just some.
So don't go anywhere. Strap in. We have more content left. Let's get on the private jet. Put him on the pilot. Take us to Europe. We're going to fly overseas. Let's go.
I think this is the biggest one so far. Sterling to Chelsea.
Done deal, bro. Sterling to Chelsea.
$65 million.
I saw 45. Oh, I saw 45. Oh, my God. The same thing we did with Jesus.
Sterling to Chelsea. Yeah, that's where we're going to start off on the European Summit for the Top Flyer podcast. Landing in England, our favorite spot. This time, London, right? That's where Chelsea's at?
Yes,
North
sir,
London.
Yes, the Kings of London.
The King. Oh, whoa, I almost said that. The Kings of London are Spurs.
What? Tottenham.
Tottenham's the king of London, mate. Tottenham's the king of London, mate. But yes, Sterling arriving to Chelsea. B, everybody here knows, the Top Flight podcast fans know, you're the biggest Chelsea fan that we got, maybe in Austin. What's your take on Sterling arriving to Chelsea off of a $85 million deal?
Nah, 47.5 is what the Sky reporting. Great signing, bro. I'm excited because I feel like Sterling felt like a little bit disrespected at City towards the end of he was at one point, I think what season was it? At one point, he was like top three in Ballon d'Or. He was like one of the top best players in the world for City.
Yeah, that was one of those mad
goals. And then, you know, slowly he's been kind of been pushed out. And I feel like City has been pushing him out, not because of his quality, but just because of, you know, there's the options there, bro. You know what I mean? We got Mahrez there and, you know, Jesus was playing the right wing. He's also one of the main players for England. You know, he did well in the Euros. He was like their only scorer throughout the group stage in England. So
yeah, facts.
I feel like he's got a lot to prove, bro, and that he's not done. So what a place to show it is if not Chelsea, man. And Tuchel seems to be leading the charge as far as who he wants. And if he wants Sterling, he's clear about him. I'm sure he has a plan for him, and I'm excited, bro. This is one of my favorite signings in a while because
something big to say.
Yeah, let me explain the fact, because we got Kai Havertz, a young up and coming.
Yes.
You know, showing bright, you know, young up and coming. Timo Werner, he had a great season with RB Leipzig, up and coming. Sterling is not one of those up and coming young. Oh, let's see what he can provide.
How old is Sterling?
I think he's.
Primo, can you pull that up? Go ahead.
He's approaching 30, if not already.
Ooh.
But Sterling.
Ooh. Bro, okay.
But Sterling is one of those players where you know what he's got.
Premier League champion.
You know, experience, scoring goals.
Okay, I see what you're saying. I see. You know what he has in his
arsenal.
You
know what he can provide, bro. Yes. It's not like we're signing an up-and-coming Kai Havertz, an up-and-coming Werner, where he can grow and maybe become someone else. You know, Ziyech, when he came in, he had a good run with Ajax, but that's it. You know what I'm saying? So Sterling has had quite a bit of runs with City, bro. You know, he's won Premier Leagues, he's won Carabaos, he's won FA Cups, he's scored hella goals, he's done it for England, for his national team. So it's a different kind of signing. And I'm, like I said, this is one of my favorite signings in a minute because of what I know he's going to provide for
Question B. We have this graphic on screen. Shout out to Primo for pulling it up. It says Raheem Sterling, Premier League 2021-2022 stats. In 30 games, he scored 13 goals and 5 assists. How many goals and assists do you think he's going to register for Chelsea next season?
He's definitely scoring double-digit goals. I think he's going to get to a double-digit assist. And these stats that we're reading off is just this coming off season that we just had right now. And I feel like – no, I don't feel like it is one of his lowest as far as stats season in City, bro, because if you go to the season before that and before that, I mean, he's scoring, like, bagging in goals left and right. And I don't think – judging him off this past season, I think, does him a disservice, bro. I think he's
27 years old, by the way.
He's 27 years old, which is great.
That makes it better.
It's not a 21-year-old come up and coming who had a glimpse of greatness and maybe he can build on Chelsea. No, it's not that type of signing, bro. It's a signing where you're like, you're done. You're ready to work. We know what you got. You know what I'm saying? So let's get it. So that's why I'm excited, bro. I'm excited, bro. I think he's going to be a key part for us next season, bro.
Bali,
I'm excited.
Question for you now. Raheem Sterling to Chelsea, good signing or panic signing by the new ownership?
Oh, no panic signing.
I think it's a good signing, but for $50 million, he's good. I'm good on that.
Oh,
$50 million, that's too little. That's
didn't
that's
you pay, little, didn't Arsenal pay a similar? Didn't Arsenal pay much. A similar amount?
Hold on, let me ask you this.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Same price, right? I mean, around the same price.
Roughly.
Jesus, Sterling, who do you get?
Don't make me pick.
Who do you get, bro? Who do you get? Answer. Who do you get? Who do you get? Sterling or Jesus?
Jesus is younger.
Sterling, bro. Sterling. You get Sterling, bro. You get Sterling.
I'll take Sterling.
You get Sterling.
You're a fucking
idiot. He's playing in some of the best teams in England.
I'm not gonna lie. I would have taken Sterling to Arsenal too. I mean, he's a good player. But,
and also, he wants to go. That's the beauty. Remember we were talking about Rafinha a couple episodes ago?
Yes.
Well, to me, in my book, you know what, bro? He can fuck off. Okay. In my book, he can fuck off.
Rafinha
wants to go to Barca. Make it, bro.
He's
Chelsea
chasing the
should.
Money. He's chasing
you
the
know
money.
What Chelsea should do with the country after? Never mind. That's what they should do to Rafinha. He can fuck off. If he comes to Chelsea, good. But it's a stain already, and you're not even part of the club, man.
Damn.
You know what I mean? Sterling wanted to come here. Yeah. He said, "I'm down. Let's get it." Tuchel, I love Tuchel. I want to play under him. So that's the type of signing that
he's never played under Thomas Tuchel.
No. Thomas Tuchel. He said he bro, Tuchel, come on, bro. He's attracting players because of what he's done with Chelsea so far.
Now, he's a great coach. Right now that we're on the topic of Chelsea, B, you want to kind of tell people why the players have been getting as jacked and juiced up as they are?
So there's been a lot of stuff on social media. Hudson-Odoi looking jacked. Mason Mount looking jacked. You know,
Christian Pulisic even looking jacked.
Christian Pulisic. Chilwell. Yeah. James has
Captain
been
America.
James, always jacked. I think there's something behind that, bro. And, you know, a lot of people, and y'all mentioned it before the pod, is like, man, you know, getting big is not always so good in soccer, bro.
Could it be something similar at the scandal that's going on in Liverpool with the asthma drugs, performance-enhancing drugs, Fucho, I'm talking to you, protecting this asthma scandal? Shout out to Primo for bringing up that article. You think this is going to help him out, bro? You think this is going to be a... You know, bad
man,
for them.
I don't think Mason Mount, Hudson-Odoi, and all these players would be doing something crazy to affect the game and gamble. I think they got a lot of support made by Tuchel.
That picture right there, they kind of like jacked
there. You know what I mean? So I think Tuchel's telling him, hey, boys, let's get strong, let's get fit, let's get big, let's get physical, because the style of play that I'm going to implement next season requires a lot of physicality.
Ooh,
and if you get big and become physical, I know y'all boys mentioned it, and it's obvious, you know, once you get that big in soccer, it's not technically a good thing, but I think that they're going to work on the fitness as far as like the cardiovascular part of the game, where the stamina
right there.
Look at that, bro.
Right there.
Look at that, bro.
That's the photo.
Look at that. Imagine bodying people up in the midfield, bro. I mean, come on.
That's something he ain't going to do though.
He going to do it. He know. Gonna do it. Mason Mount has
the
body.
He does
bro.
Look pretty swell. I'm not gonna lie.
You think Mason Mount has a starting position in the England World Cup squad?
I mean, I don't know.
That's a tough question.
Maybe. He is quality. He is good. I think he has to come in the season and play great, and play good for him to actually get a starting position, because there's so many players in the England squad. I mean, England is stacked up. I mean, they have players all over that can come in and stuff. So
that's true.
He needs to come in and do something.
Mason Mount is in the hearts of every Chelsea fan, bro. He is the most loved player in Chelsea, other than N'Golo Kante, because he's homegrown, academy product. I mean, God, he's like my favorite player, bro. Yeah. I think he is my favorite player, bro. My
Lukaku,
favorite player. Fuck Lukaku. I called it. Didn't I call it? Nah. Fuck off. Didn't I call? As soon as that interview came out, I said he can get the fuck out of my club.
Guess
what happened? He's out, bro. He's out. Good.
He's done.
He's done, bro.
Hey, and Chris is in, no? Chris.
So we'll get to that. I mean, Chris? I guess we can go to it now.
Alright, let's go, Primo.
Yeah.
You wanna go ahead?
Can we go to Chris, Primo?
Yeah, we'll bring it up.
Chris viene. Chris va. Chris ahí.
Say it, Primo. Say it, though. Say it. Next topic.
Next topic. Ronaldo to Chelsea.
Ronaldo.
I can't believe this is happening, bro. Never in my life did I picture Cristiano in a Chelsea blue kit.
So it's kind of weird.
Never in my life.
It all starts with Ronaldo not going to training, but the club said it was because family issues. I think it's fairly obvious to real fans that Ronaldo does not want to play Europa League with United.
Nope.
He's not going to sit and stay and be part of this rebuilding process with Ten Hag. So Bicho wants out, and rightfully so, in my opinion. So where can he go? Bayern is in talks. Chelsea's in talks. That's about it. PSG can afford him, but I don't think.
Last dance. It doesn't seem like that. We're looking for a backup striker.
But to be fair, I think the main two teams that are realistically in candidate for him is Chelsea and Bayern, bro.
Yeah.
And for us, for me as a fan, as a Chelsea fan, to even consider this a possibility, it kind of hits me, bro. Like, what? It hits me to the point where I'm at work during break and I'm scrolling. I'm like, what? El Bicho. You know, and I sent a text to the group chat. You screenshot it because I was hyped up.
Look at this video. Yeah. A fan asked Thomas Tuchel for an autograph outside like a training center. And it says, we asked Thomas Tuchel, are we signing Cristiano Ronaldo? Thomas Tuchel says, I'm not telling you that.
I'm not going to tell you.
And he laughs.
That's basically saying, he's on his way.
I think so, bro. And you know what, bro? I'm going to say this. I'm a Big Cris fan. So is Primo. So is Danny Band. So is Neff. Half of the Top Flight podcast. And
fanboys.
We're watching TV. I think this has a lot to do with the new ownership.
Yes.
Todd Boehly is, you know, starting his new ownership. He wants to start it with a bang. Yep. There's no better way for an American owner to come in and sign a fucking legend of the game. You know what I'm saying? I think Todd Boehly is pushing for it.
And you know what's also Todd, which is weird to me, is that he himself is personally going and negotiating.
I've seen that.
Himself, damn. Bro. Roman.
Look at this. Look at this edit. Oh my God. Question is, though, is Kante going to give up number 7?
I think he would. Kante would give up anything, bro. He is just a sweetheart of a player, bro. Yeah. I mean, he's just. He drives a Mini Cooper, bro.
What?
He drives like a 2013 Mini Cooper, bro. What? Like, you know, that's the type of player he is. But yeah, Todd is going. Bro, there was a video of him pulling up to meet with Barcelona about the future of Azpilicueta and Marcos Alonso, which everything between the players are said and done, you know. Yep. But the money is involved, and you know, Barca's broke as fuck. So to me, it amazes me that he himself, the owner, is going and negotiating this stuff.
It's interesting.
That's awesome, bro.
I think he wants to learn as much as he can.
Yes, that's true. That's also true.
But Bali, one question for you, bro.
Yeah.
If Ronaldo leaves Man United to join a direct rival in the top four, which is Chelsea, you think there's going to be idiotic Man United fans that are going to burn this legend's jersey? What is going to be the reaction in Manchester to this? Because this is going to be big, bro. Big.
United all around, they always judge and disrespect their players. I mean, you see it all the time on social media. So I wouldn't be surprised if some United fan goes off and says some stuff about United. They shouldn't, though. To me, man, this new ownership of Chelsea, you know, I'm not gonna lie, you know, they're trying to make moves. You know, they want Dembele, they want Rafinha, they want Sterling. They're out here, but Cristiano? I honestly think that y'all shouldn't go for Cristiano. I think if anything, Cristiano wouldn't suit y'all well. I think if Cristiano wants to go somewhere, I think he should go to Bayern.
I got this.
To me,
I got this.
And I honestly think that Cristiano's more like a let's sell jerseys move. To me, you know, that's what I think. To me, he should have.
I got a take on that. I got you.
Cristiano should go to Bayern and just his career. I mean, let me say done, this, G. You know, let me tell you something, G. Right now, is Havertz, is Cristiano better than Kai Havertz right now, B?
100%.
Cristiano's better than Kai Havertz.
How many goals did Kai Havertz score in the Premier League compared to how many goals Ronaldo scored in the Premier League?
No, but I'm saying, but is he better right
look
now?
Look at
like,
the team Kai Havertz had around him. Look at the team Ronaldo
against each other.
Bro, okay, listen.
Like skill wise, who's
Ronaldo is a better player.
Ronaldo's dumb, bro. Ronaldo,
Linda.
Saka's better than Ronaldo. Linda. Martinelli is better than Ronaldo, bro.
Oh, my days.
Bro, back-to-back shit takes by Bali. Back-to-back shit takes.
Come on, bro.
Rare.
Come on, bro.
It happens. It happens to the best of
us. To the fans, and I've saw a lot of this, United fans. Ronaldo came in and ruined this club. Oh, we were better without Ronaldo. Look at the difference with Ronaldo. Blaming Ronaldo when Ronaldo was the main man for your club, bro. Same thing with Juve. The problem is Ronaldo is too big. It's such a great asset. Ronaldo is like the cherry on top of clubs where there needs to be a team that can handle him. If you have a team of mediocre players who are just there for 2-3 years who just want to earn the paycheck, Ronaldo comes in and he's like looking around the club, looking around the locker room, he's like, nah, I don't see hunger here. Then your club goes to shit because the Ronaldo expects a certain level from everybody in the club, bro. And if you're not stepping up to that level, then you're like, oh, then I'm done. Same thing with United. He did that at Juve, bro. He came in, looked around like, you're not at my level. Step up. I need everybody to step up. They didn't. United, he saw, you know, the Freds, the Lingards, the Rashford's form going to shit. He demands a certain level from the players around him, bro. And at Chelsea, he will get that level. He will get that hunger from Mason Mount, from Hudson-Odoi, from all Kai Havertz, from a coach who demands a certain level from his players already. You know what I mean? What Pirlo, was he demanding some sort of level from his players at Juve? No, he wasn't. Was this fucking legend, what's Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, was he demanding some sort? He was a nice guy. Oh, we're good here.
Pleasing.
People, pleasing. An interim coach who supposedly was his genius didn't do shit. At Chelsea, you have a proven coach in Thomas Tuchel, bro, and a group of players who are going to want to elevate to that level and match Ronaldo's ability. So, to me, I think it would be a great signing for us. But, and this is the last point I'm going to make, it will be a more difficult because Bayern is also there. And in Bayern, you got the league wrapped up. You got the Copa wrapped up. You got at least a quarter semifinals in the Champions League. At Chelsea, you're going to be fighting against City, Liverpool week in, week out, mate. FA Cup is not guaranteed, mate. Top four is not guaranteed, mate. Champions League is not guaranteed, mate. So that's a decision you make, and that's up to him. Yeah. You know, Messi chose to go to a PSG. Look what happened.
Didn't work out.
And I feel like Ronaldo's mentality, man, I hope he comes to Chelsea, bro. I'm down, bro. Great.
I think we're going to clip that. We're definitely going to clip that. But fantastic take. I really don't have anything else to add on that. I think B hit everything spot on. Bali, you good?
Yeah, Bali. Next topic. What we got next?
I mean, when Ronaldo came in, he had just bought Jadon Sancho, which is going to be your guy.
He bought him. United was going to be the guy for United.
And then Ronaldo came in, and then what happened?
Look who's coaching the club.
Now you have to play around Ronaldo. It is what it is.
You had a Ole Gunnar Solskjaer.
At the end of the day, I could care less about United.
An interim coach.
If Ronaldo goes to Chelsea, good luck, Chelsea.
You know what I'm going to say? I'm going to diss a lot of people.
So far, right now, you're doing pretty good, Chelsea. But if you get Ronaldo,
The people tweeting, hating Ronaldo for what they did, United fans are the same Messi fanboys who are going to hate Ronaldo no matter what, bro. That's what I'm going to say, bro. Ronaldo to Chelsea, it's going to be a collective. It's not going to be a Ronaldo thing. It's going to be a Chelsea thing, mate. You know what I mean? At United, he went. It was Ronaldo. And he's going to bring that to Chelsea. But Chelsea is a collective, bro. Man, I want him at the club, bro. I want him at Chelsea. I'm going to say it. I want him at Chelsea, bro.
As a Real Madrid fan, Lukaku
2.0. We'll be here.
No.
Again.
What?
Put some respect on his name.
Put some respect on his name, bro.
We'll be here again, bro. You said the same thing about Lukaku like a couple months ago. So we'll see.
I did not say the same thing. As soon as he had that interview, I wanted him out.
Last thing, bro. If Ronaldo wants to win Champions League again, Chelsea's a really good team to be in. Or, like you said, Bayern.
Bayern.
They won't win the Champions League if he goes there.
He's going to just – league is done. Copa's done. He's going to be fighting for the Champions League only.
And especially if Lewa dips. Or they could use Chris as a way to tell Lewa, look, you want to play with Chris? Stay. More seasons.
Lewa wants out, bro. Yeah, I think Ronaldo doesn't come to Bayern unless Lewa leaves.
But Lewa said he wanted new emotion. He said that he felt dead inside. But maybe Chris re-sparks that competition flame in him.
Yeah, but Ronaldo's going to want to play nine.
Yeah, or what if Man United and Bayern do a...
Then I don't want to do that.
It's more complicated. See, it's complicated. Barca wants Lewa. It's complicated. Chelsea is not Barca late. How much you want,
though,
bro?
One thing though, a Bayern legend, Lothar Matthaus, big Bayern legend, came out and said Ronaldo to Bayern, it would be sexy. Sexy.
It would be sexy at Chelsea,
sexy.
Too.
He would. Yeah, it would.
You'd
be
going up against Haaland. Ooh. Against Liverpool, mate.
Honestly, I think he's going to choose Chelsea. I think he's going to choose Chelsea, mate.
Oh, man, imagine.
I think he's going to choose Chelsea. I think he's choosing Chelsea.
Me mojo.
I wouldn't hate him. I would be watching hella Chelsea games if that happened, bro, because I just signed up to Peacock. We in that thing, bro.
You know what I mean? So, man, I'm excited, bro.
Primo, happy. Next topic, please, bro.
Next topic,
Can you imagine, Primo? Hold on, Primo. Can you imagine the Sue at the Stamford Bridge, mate?
Yeah, that'd be crazy.
That'd be
a big move. I hope it happens.
Yeah, me too.
Next topic: Tyler Adams to Leeds.
Ooh. Yes, that's a good move. Another good move. American to the EPL.
Yeah.
A lot of what's his name? The guy from ESPN FC, not Stevie Nichol, Craig Burnley. Craig Burnley was getting some shit for saying, oh, well, if Leeds doesn't get – if they don't stay in the EPL, if they get sent back to Division Two, you can just blame the – you can blame the coach, blame Tyler Adams, Brendan Aaronson. Pretty much he was saying blame the kids from USA.
That's fucked. Plus, I mean, come on. If you're fighting relegation at a certain point, you're getting sacked. It's not like you're going to go down with the ship. You know what I mean?
He is trying to bring a lot of the U.S. talent to the Leeds, but, I mean – you're fighting for your life the last game of the season. So if this is the way you're going, you know, just make sure this is the right way to go because you got a lot on the line. March. Jesse.
Brian Canales.
Yes.
Shout out Brian Canales. He's a big fan of U.S. men's national team players, and he's been retweeting a lot of good articles and stuff like that surrounding these different moves, bro. And there's been a lot of American players going to the EPL, bro.
Yeah, I'm going to keep an eye on Leeds just because of that, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, what's the name of the coach?
Jesse.
Jesse Marsh.
March.
Yes. Jesse Marsh, bro. We have to give him credit, man. Yeah. I mean, Tyler Adams, Leeds United, $23 million deal. Now,
you know,
this isn't just like a random signing. They've played together before.
Yeah.
Go ahead, B.
I mean, the last American coach was El Pelon. Bob Bradley. And he was fired in five games. So
he was coaching Fulham?
He was coaching Swansea.
Swansea.
Five games sacked. So I think he's doing great. I wish him well. If Leeds ends up being in another relegation battle, I don't think I would count that as like success. I think that would be a failure, bro.
Shout out to the fan at Mr. Tramps. I was wearing the Leeds jersey.
Oh, I remember.
He was mad. He told Vinicius, "Get up, you cheating bastard!"
Yeah.
He's like, "Damn, dude."
We were watching
like,
the final at Tramps, and he was very enthusiastic.
What'd you tell him though?
I was like, "Nah, I don't." I don't even know what to say. I forgot.
You said, "Shut
I was
up."
Like, wait.
It's your like, team's coached by an American. Yeah, shut up.
Because you know English, they have like this stigma against Americans. They do. Within the sport. So I was like, yeah, hey, bro, your club's being coached by Americans. So.
100%. Shout out to Tyler Adams for making this jump because
excited.
I think he had another offer where he was just going to stay like, I guess, in the same position where he is.
Yeah.
But joining Leeds, you know what I'm saying? Like, he's not going to be on the bench. You know, they're not going to let this guy rot on the bench for 23 million. I'm thinking he's in Jesse Marsh's plans.
If I'm here, that's an easy decision. Right?
23 million. Yeah. Come on.
What do you think, Bali? Is he in the plans?
Is he 23 million? Are you
mad? Are you mad?
Is he gonna? You paying 23 million?
I'm asking.
You're paying 23 million.
I'm asking you a question, bro.
Yeah.
I'm asking you a question.
Bro, he's buying him to start him, bro, because he's gonna make the team better. You're not gonna buy a player and put him on the bench.
It's an easy decision to go.
Just a question.
He gets like that after a shit take. He gets like that after a shit take.
Oh,
stupid question. I'm just saying, it's a stupid question.
All right, man. Shout out to Tyler Adams. Shout out to all the American lads making moves to Europe, making the dreams come true, though. Shout out to them, bro. Danny Pereira soon to go, by the way. Danny Pereira soon to go.
I hope not, bro. I want him to stay here for a while.
Hopefully, I don't know.
Hopefully, he stays here
after
for a minute.
After he gets a chip.
Let's win a couple titles and then you can leave, Danny.
I guarantee you, Owen Wolf, two seasons, he's gone.
Yeah, bro. Yeah,
Barcelona.
Like, he's such
Barcelona.
A talent, bro.
Barcelona.
He's such a talent.
On loan, man.
100% Barcelona. Primo, what's the next topic other than the Tyler Adams, bro?
After we got, I guess we could talk about the guys coming to the MLS. Bale.
Oh, yeah. We did.
And,
we talk about
Bale. Hector.
Just real quick, on my part, I'm really excited for Gareth Bale to be in LAFC. I'm excited for him to come to Austin so we can smack him up. One interesting thing, though. He spoke Spanish in an LAFC promo. And he, in Spain, it was known that Gareth Bale did not know how to speak Spanish. And that's why the fan culture did not connect with him, because he refused to speak Spanish to the media. And then you come to LA and you drop a full promo in Spanish saying the 3-2-5-2, you're excited to see them, all this shit. Fuck off, Gareth Bale. Fuck off, dude. Like, enough is enough, man. Like, you already milked us $500,000 a week and you're still carrying on with your bullshit, bro. Leave us alone, bro. Leave us alone, dude. Like, you're out of our head. You're out of our mind. Like, just stop it.
Yeah.
Just stop it. You're a toxic ex, and we're done with you, bro. We're done with you, Gareth Bale.
Yeah.
That fool messed me up.
Yeah.
That fool messed me up, bro.
Emotionally?
Emotionally. Bro, think about it. He delivers in a Champions League final with a badass overhead kick, and then he don't even want to play for you. And then he goes to Wales, and he has this flag that says Wales, Golf Madrid. That fool messed me up emotionally, bro. He messed me up, fam.
But, I mean, let's be real. He's kind of, I mean, he's just 1 year, right? Just 1 year?
1 year.
Option for two.
So, you know, World Cup's coming up. You know, Wales is in it. So, he doesn't want to just chill around until the World Cup. So, I see it as a tune-up for the World Cup, in my opinion, bro. Like a little World Cup preseason in LA. So, we'll see.
A lot of fans thought he was going to play against the Galaxy, though. He didn't feature.
No, he didn't feature. I'm excited, like you mentioned, to see him in Austin where...
Yeah, and honestly,
that's gonna be crazy.
By him not starting that game, he got to see LAFC win a big Trafico.
Yes, bro,
the 3-2-5-2, I don't know if y'all saw their supporter section, but it was fucking insane.
Yeah.
Shout out to the guys from LAFC Infiltro. Chila is a capo. The freaking 3-2-5-2 was insane, bro.
What
and,
was that, Bali?
And Bill got to see all that. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, so I think that's incredible good. For him. That's but good. Let's move to Ache Ache. What's your take on him?
I mean, we kind of spoke about him a little bit on the preview of the Houston game. I mean, you know, it just, to me, it says a lot about the club, you know, just bringing in a name, trying to sell some jerseys. I think their main priority is trying to put people in the stadium. So, yep. you
they've
know.
Been doing it.
They've been, you know, they've been trying to bring the Mexican fan base into it, but I don't know, man. It's not really as exciting as like a Bell to LAFC or like an Insignia to Toronto, in my opinion. Yeah. I think out of all those three, I think Achach is more like, it is what it is. You know, a lot of Mexicans in Houston, so
yeah.
That's my overall take.
Bali, thoughts on Achach?
I don't care about him. That's career-ending move.
Washed up, huh?
I've been tagging him. I told him it's a sad story. I've been tagging him on Twitter. Hopefully, he reads my tweet because I'm
mourning. He speaks English, bro.
Yeah.
Oh, he doesn't.
He doesn't speak.
English. Oh, well, I'll tweet you in Spanish now, so you can understand.
He did an interview with Hercules Gomez and Sebastian Salazar.
I did listen to that
in all Spanish, which is kind of weird. It was kind of weird, real quick, because Sebastian Salazar understood Spanish, but he couldn't speak it. You know what I'm saying?
I thought he could.
Well, I don't know because Hercules Gomez was giving the questions. Whatever. Just check out the interview.
I think they both know.
Yeah. I think they both know.
Check out the interview. Keep going, buddy.
But overall, the reality is that he was at Atletico. He wanted to renew his contract. Cholo said, "Nah, man, you're not good enough anymore. You're old." Houston came through.
Is that what he said?
Houston came through. They said, "Look, this is the project. This is the money right here that we're going to give you. We're going to take care of your family. We're going to give you this. We're going to give you that. We're going to give you a home.
You're a king here.
And you're a king here. People will love you." Great. I'm all for it. Because why? Because his family is set.
I bet you in that contract negotiation, there was zero talk about stuff on the pitch.
Exactly. He can say in his interview, the project was nice. I think it's a good project for the team. Bullshit, bro. The money was good.
Yes.
Your family's good.
And you're closer to Mexico.
Yeah. And you probably got a beautiful home in Houston, Texas. So, hey, life is good for you, bro. That's why you came here.
One thing that I do want to point out, Ache Ache in the interview with Sebastian Salazar and Hercules Gomez on Football Americas, right?
Yes.
Football Americas. He said that the Houston, I think the coach or whoever handles transfers, they pulled up on him in Madrid with a big bottle of wine. And they just sat there and talked, just drinking wine until they came to a deal. Now, what I want to know is what the hell was in that wine?
They got him drunk.
They got him drunk.
And then he signed the deal.
They got him. They got this gentleman, this professional, intoxicated, and they got his signature.
They should launch an investigation, bro.
They should launch an investigation into the Houston Dynamo as early as Monday morning. ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, yeah.
Anything else you want to
Insigne? Yeah. Hey.
What did he say?
I saw something on Twitter online saying that he quoted saying, "I am not the savior." I was like, "I'm not gonna save this club."
I think everyone in Toronto is expecting him to come in and save them and bring them back to the top. Yeah. I think that's a lot of pressure for him. I think he's seeing it now.
I think Insigne is looking at Achache's deal. He was like, "I kind of wanted that.
I thought MLS was that.
Yeah, I wanted that.
Wait, I gotta perform for you guys. Oh no. Oh, is this it right here?
Yeah,
I think that's just a quote. Can't see.
Hey, man, he's a great player. I'm also excited.
He is a great player. Toronto right now. He's gonna help Toronto definitely. They're not playing.
He's
too
gonna
well.
Help Toronto. He's not there to save
but
him.
He's not there to save them.
Agree
he's
with him.
Not,
I kind of see what we're trying to say. Like, don't put pressure on me, dog. I'm not here to save you.
Yeah. I think he's seen it all over social media. Like, hey, you're here to bring us back to the top. Yeah. And he knows that
he's a big signing, bro. He's still he is
a big signing, bro.
So I guess that's expected, you know.
And this is kind of why I'm okay with Austin FC making these low key signings or whatever, these quote unquote rejects from other teams, bro. We're building a great structure where there's no egos, like you said earlier, and we're just building
the
a great
negotiations
team,
with Austin FC is on the pitch. The negotiations with other clubs is how much money, what house, seats in the stadium, you know, shirt sales, all that shit. So we don't need help because a beer at Q2 is $25. So
a graphic from Next Generation Football. Shout out to Next Gen. We got Chiellini also there as well.
Chiellini
to LAFC?
Man, I don't know, man. He's his
retirement
age.
League move.
That is his age, man. I don't know, but I guess
retirement
if
league
I guess
move,
if you want to
bro.
Play in your late 30s as a center back, MLS is the place to do it.
I'm pretty sure they gave him a good little bag, a little good money.
LA too.
Now, good
now
weather.
Suarez is being linked to the MLS just to bite Chiellini. just just to bite him, bro. Nah. Again.
Nah, I heard that he might. No, supposedly he was going to go to River or something, but that. It didn't happen.
Supposedly he's going to River.
Maybe. There was rumors, but I don't think it's happening.
I mean, he might end up in the MLS, Inter Miami, owned by David Beckham. Messi's rumored to go there to the New York City FC.
I don't want him at Austin, bro.
Ownership.
I don't know if you want to bring that up, but. Before you do, I'm good.
Luis Suarez? Of course not. What the fuck? No.
Yeah, I think if he comes to the league, though, it would be good, you know, whichever team he comes. Whichever team he comes.
Don't be too sure. There's a lot of Austin FC fans that would be like, Suarez? Yeah. Sign him up. Yeah. I mean, sign him up. Come on, come on, man.
I'm not dissing the player. I'm just saying, we're good.
Let's be real. Let's be real with these signings.
Let's be realistic.
Drusy, let's have him as our biggest star right now. Everybody else is having working for Drusy. Yeah. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm down.
Working ants. Yeah. Primo, is that it for the Top Flight podcast, bro?
That's it right there.
That's good. Good episode. I want to send a shout out to everybody that's been checking us out on YouTube, on Twitter, Instagram. We've been doing a lot of action, a lot of moves on Twitter lately in the pre-match Twitter space and the post-game Twitter spaces. Now, pre-game, every away game, we're going to try to do a 30-minute pre-game space, get y'all taken on the lineup. Always after the match ends, post-match Twitter spaces. Next game is on Tuesday at home. The fan mic, the fan reactions are back. Make sure to check that out. B, any statements from you?
Man, I don't know, man. Let's two big Texas derbies. I'm excited for the one in Houston at home and then Dallas away at Frisco. Man, this week alone would probably is going to shape the season, bro, in my opinion.
100%. Yeah. And if you enjoy the Top Flight podcast, if you enjoy Warehousing TV, B, what can they do?
You can tell a friend. Subscribe if you haven't already. Tell your friend to subscribe just for the fuck up. Be like, hey, bro, just subscribe real quick. You know, we're trying to get to 1,000 subs. That's a big
road
goal
to
for
1,000. Road to 1,000. We're almost halfway there.
So if you love what we do, if you enjoy the content that we put out, the podcast, everything, leave a comment, tell a friend, you know, help us out.
A lot of fans have been asking us when we're going to start a Patreon. It's in the works, y'all. We're going to get it going for y'all soon. Expect a Patreon. We're asking TV, Top Flight Podcast here real soon. Now, Bali. Closing statements from you. What do you got to say to the fans that really love your takes?
Oh, man, thank you so much, bro. I always see on my Twitter, my mentions, people showing me love. I thank you, man. Thank
people
you for
love
the support.
Your takes.
Yeah, bro. It's the voice of the people. You know, Bali. You know, we keeping it real right here. We don't sugarcoat shit here. Yeah. No, I'm gonna let you know straight up. And B knew what's up last week, and they ended up cutting the video.
You were talking like you won or some shit. There was nothing to win about.
It is what it is.
You know what I mean? So
you want to tell us about the signatures?
Oh, the signatures. You know, I got my boys right here, Austin FC players. You know, my G's. You know, family. You know, you see Julio, you see Donnie, you see
Charlie,
everybody here.
Charlie Asensio went on loan, by the way.
Charlie went on loan. My G Charlie. Hey, good luck on loan, G. You know?
Good move.
I want to thank the fans. The fans have been, the love and the support that we've been receiving, bro, has been unbelievable. And just keep supporting us. We're here to give you the content, the best content, the best Austin FC content, the best European content, everything. And we are the best of the best in Austin.
Primo, before I sign off, anything you want to say?
I mean, it's been an amazing season so far. We're getting these points against big teams, and we got the derby coming up. Excited about that. So, you know, we'll see y'all on Tuesday.
Let's do it, y'all. This has been the Top Flight Podcast. Thank you for your support. Like B said, tell a friend, and we'll see you here back real soon. Y'all, it's been the Top Flight Podcast. You already know.